Maggie, I want to start with where the committee really ended yesterday, with the claim from Zoe Lofgren that the big lie became a big grift. Those were her words, that the Trump campaign or post-Trump campaign was trying to raise money off of the big lie. We since learned from her interview with Jake and other people afterwards that the committee has found information that Kimberly Guilfoyle was paid $60,000 to speak at the rally on January 6th. $60,000 for a speech that was, what, 3 minutes?
If that,
3 minutes long. And what have you heard over the last several hours since that revelation about how people in Trump world feel about that?
So I want to say two things about that. People in Trump world are sharing that clip. They are aghast that this is the amount of money that she got for a speech to introduce her boyfriend. They couldn't really get over. I had one former advisor say to me, essentially, these were folks who were raising money in small amounts from retirees, telling them this was going to some legal fight that didn't really happen, and instead Kimberly Guilfoyle is getting paid. But this is the whole ecosystem. So it's fine that some people are upset about this, but there's some level of this that often goes on around Trump, and it shouldn't be a surprise to anyone.
Well, sure. We've seen the way he deals with finances before.
That's
and
right.
The way the system around him operates. Do you think Trump supporters care, Phil? Are they going to be mad? The retirees who are on a fixed income donating a few dollars and it goes someplace where they are not expecting it to go?
Well, I think there's two aspects of that question. The first is the extent to which they're going to be familiar with the details of this, which obviously is the broader question about the January 6th committee in general. But secondarily, if you look at actually the timeline here, Donald Trump's Save America PAC raised nine figures last year, raised tens of millions of dollars well after there was any case to be made for a legal fight against the election results. The last legal fight ended at the end of 2020, but he's still raising tens of millions of dollars from folks. So it seems as though a lot of this money is simply expressing support for Donald Trump, which is something, you know, I looked yesterday, he sent out 17 fundraising emails, right? Like, this is something that's been ongoing for a long time, is totally detached from the election results itself. So I find it hard to believe this will make much of a dent.
You know, the former president put out this 12-page response yesterday, which included more lies about election fraud. Maggie, what are you hearing in terms of his perception of what's happening in these hearings? Are there things that sting more than others?
There are. I want to say one thing about what we were just saying about whether this will make a difference with his voters. It may not, but it might make a difference with legal officials, right? I mean, there is a fraud aspect that they're looking at here. So this is not purely politics. So that's one. In terms of his response, he put out a 12-page screed, for lack of a better way of putting it, last night, defending himself essentially and saying that he believed all of these things that were being said because look at what was said in conservative media. This is why I went with this. This is why I went with that. He is clearly setting up a defense, either publicity-wise or possibly legal, to say, I really did believe this, therefore I didn't do anything wrong, and we will see where that all goes.
The topic for Wednesday's hearing is Trump corruptly planned to replace the attorney general so the Justice Department would spread his false stolen election claims. How do you see, I mean, I would imagine, of course, Bill Barr is going to factor again very largely in this. How do you see this playing out?
Well, I mean, this is the story that we heard, right, where there was this effort to try and replace the head of the Justice Department in order to put more focus, particularly on Georgia. And there was this guy who sort of came up through the ranks out of nowhere to potentially be that person who all of a sudden is in charge of the Justice Department. I think the important thing to remember about this is that what the committee is trying to do is not simply say, here's what happened at the Capitol. They are instead trying to say, here was this broad push to try and steal a second term in office for Donald Trump that happened to manifest on January 6th at the Capitol in a riot, but also manifested in all of these other ways as well. And since the committee's focus is in part trying to figure out how do you block this from happening in the future, this is an important part of that. How do you make it so that a president can't simply say, you know what, all of a sudden there's a new head of the Justice Department and we're pointing at fraud in Georgia. How do you keep that from happening? And I think this is an important part of that story.
Maggie, can I just pick up on one thing you were saying there about what the president's defense might be going forward and the results of this 12-page thing? Because it gets to the Bill Barr testimony yesterday and the one sentence that a lot of people think was the singular headline from it, which was that Trump was detached from reality.
What he said is if he really believes this, then he is detached from reality. I don't think that he was adjudicating whether Trump believed it or not. And I think the other thing you were seeing the committee try to show is he should have known this wasn't true. Even if he wanted to believe it, even if he really did believe it, there were so many people. Part of what was so key about Barr's testimony, other than the fact that it was breathtaking from a former attorney general and a person who was seen by a lot of people as doing what Trump wanted throughout that presidency at various points. But Barr was basically saying, we looked at this. It's not that we just dismissed this outright. The Justice Department went over all of these claims. We ran these things to ground. there was nothing there, and Trump was still insisting it was. And so that if, I think, was important. I don't know what that if will mean, if anything, legally.
Maggie Haberman, Philip Bump, great to see you both in person. Thanks so much.